Okay. Well, let me introduce everyone to John Fallows, VE6EY. Now, that's a call sign, just like WCCO or any radio or TV facility, amateur radio. For those who aren't familiar with amateur radio, it's a licensed communication service as a hobby. It's a worldwide thing, and the call signs all fall into a particular scheme. So, and it all, you might also find that amateur radio operators are really curious people, and they're the ones who do a lot of research and development. And I was pleased to find John Fallows on QSO today. Now, he was presenting a paper on diversity reception, multiple receivers tied together to improve the signal-to-noise ratio on reception. And I thought, well, here's something that us broadcast engineers, or when I was a broadcast engineer, now I'm a retired guy. And John, I think, as I recall, you are too. But tell us first about how your history in broadcast engineering before we get to the diversity thing.
So in junior high school, I became a broadcast band DXer. And I belonged to a club called the Canadian International DX Club, which actually was based in a house about a block away from me. And so that got me started. And then I started playing around with announcing when I was in high school. Also got my ham license. And my first real full-time paid job was doing the overnight show on the CJOB in Winnipeg, which back in the 70s was actually the radio station with the highest adult market share in North America. It was actually pretty amazing because we did adult programming with lots of sports, and all the other stations were going after 15-year-old girls with rock and roll. And so we kind of had the market to ourselves. And over the years, I actually did a pretty much every job in a radio station. I was operations manager, responsible for engineering for a while I was at CJOB. And being a ham kind of helped because I understood radio from a technical point of view and also from a announcing and management point of view. So that started a career in broadcasting. Eventually, I went back to school and got my MBA and went into management consulting, and ended up at Ernst & Young and then at EDS for a while, and then I retired 10 years ago. So that's a snapshot.
Okay, proceed.
So about 7 years ago, my ham station started being jammed by a very, very strong interference, which I later discovered was coming from a poorly wired halogen light set up in a neighbor's house around 300 feet to the west. And since I couldn't remove it at source, I started trying to find all sorts of ways to null it out. And that led me down a path which eventually led me to modern diversity reception. So I'm going to tell you what that is today and take you through it, what its history is, how it works. I'll skip the math. There's one slide with a formula, but you don't have to actually read it. And I'll give you a demonstration video and then tell you what I'm using in my Radio Shack. So a modern diversity receiver, there's three things you got to know. First, you need a dual channel receiver. You need a receiver, ideally a software-defined radio that has two channels or more, and each channel can work up a separate antenna, and the antennas are spaced a bit apart. Now, the channels have to be coherent. They have to have a common local oscillator or clock and a common analog digital converter. And the whole idea is you run these two receivers completely synchronized, and then you output the baseband data and do something with it. When you're playing around with what's called IQ data at baseband, if you vary the amplitude and phase of the two separate channels, you can combine the signals constructively or destructively. And that's essentially diversity reception. State of the art, all of these leading ham transceivers have dual channel coherent signal chains. but only two of them have the ability to provide synchronous IQ data from both channels, and only one of them gives you the ability to actually do something with that data at baseband, and that's the Anan radio shown on the lower left. All of the others expect you to do a diversity reception with a pair of headphones and let your ears sort of do the math for you to make it work. And by the way, it doesn't work that well. So the three features of modern diversity reception are really three. These have been around for a while. You get diversity gain, array gain, and my favorite, which is noise cancellation. And I'll show you how all of these things work. The use case for traditional diversity gain is to mitigate multipath fading. Over the years, many shortwave broadcasters transmitted around the world, and receiving stations would use typically three different receivers on three different antennas to mix the signals together and get the best quality.
John, I'm not seeing the slides change. We're still on the first one.
Okay. I don't know why that's happening.
There we go.
Okay, well, I'll just leave it on this screen. Mm-hmm. Next is beamforming or array gain. And that's where you basically phase your two antennas together, either analog or digital. And you can get a beam to form just by adding or subtracting the patterns from each antenna. And then lastly, the local RFI reduction. This has been around with audio noise canceling headphones since the 1930s. For the past really 25 or 30 years, you've used outboard analog cancelers to do this. And now we do it in digital form right within the receiver. I'm gonna try going back to the large slides. Are these changing?
No.
You know, I've never been able to figure out why that works sometimes and doesn't work other times. Sorry about that. So anyway, back in 1926, Beveridge invented this whole thing. There's a picture of him tuning two different receivers to do diversity reception. He invented AVC as part of an effort to mix audio and get the stronger signal to control the signal chain. So that's part of that history. The Holocrafters came out with a diversity receiver in the 1930s. And this actually, those two dials aren't for different receivers. The one dial on the left is the main tuning and the one on the right is bandspread. Some of you who are of a certain age will remember what bandspread was. But this became a standard during the 1930s. And the target was multipath fading. So, I mean, if we were talking on the radio right now on, say, 20 meters, Mark, signal from your station to mine would come along slightly different paths, depending on how many layers of the ionosphere it bounced off or refracted through. And so sometimes your signal would fade down because of the multipath effect. And the original idea of diversity reception was to fight the multipath effect. And here's some racks of AR-88 receivers used during the 40s, 50s, and 60s for diversity reception. So this isn't a new thing. Diversity gain, you can get it with space diversity, which is what I use with two antennas spaced apart, or you can get it with different polarization of the antennas. Or you can actually do it on different frequencies. So there's various methods to do this and to get an improvement. And the whole idea is the more elements you have and the way you're able to mix them, you can actually get a diversity gain, although there's limited diminishing returns from that. Array gain is basically steering the nulls and lobes of your antenna. And this works because wave fronts arrive at two or more antennas at different times. And because of that, there's a phase difference. And when you add it all together, you get sort of a beam or a null. And with diversity reception array gain, you can tune the null or you can tune the lobe to sort of steer your beam. And like everybody's using this stuff now. The cell phone towers will have 5 or 6 antennas. They'll do beam steering automatically to optimize the signals. It's very commonplace, but normally it's behind the scenes. And even in your home, if you have a Wi-Fi hub with 2 or 3 antennas on the back, it's doing beamforming, picking the best quality from those different signals that arrive on the different antennas. So this is not something that's really out there. This is a very common practice, but a lot of people just haven't heard about it or really understand it. You can do it analog or digital. If you want to do analog beamforming, you need some sort of box that you can adjust the phase between multiple antennas before they get to your receiver. Or if you're like me on the right-hand side, you just do that all inside your receiver. After you down-convert to baseband, you can multiply by a set of weights to change the phase of each channel and increase or decrease the amplitude of each channel. So here's the primer. The concept is two receivers that are coherent or they're slaved together and you somehow combine the signals from them. The old way of doing this has been to wear a pair of stereo headphones and listen to each channel separately. And that does cause some effect, but quite frankly, the human method is really not the best method. And unfortunately, most of our ham radio manufacturers are stuck in the 1920s paradigm of diversity reception and what it can do, and they're really missing out. This is the one slide with math in it. I've got 3 receivers currently that do diversity. One's from Israel, called the Ephedri. The other's the RSP Duo. And finally, the Anand 7000. And each of these has a separate channel with a shared oscillator and a shared clock. And each channel has its own conversion. And then that little formula on the left represents the complex weights you can multiply in a matrix, the baseband data. You can get signals to add or subtract. Array gain is deterministic. So it assumes each antenna receives an identical copy of the signal at a slightly different time. And by combining the slight differences, either adding them or subtracting them, you can create lobes with your antennas. And you can create your average signal to noise ratio. So this is what people do with a foursquare or various types of phased verticals, and it works, and it works very well, especially if you have 4 antennas, you can create some really interesting patterns. Diversity gain is statistical. It's not deterministic. It basically assumes the arrival of randomly different copies of the signal due to multipath, and what you can do is you can use various combining strategies to improve the probability of a better signal to noise ratio. And that's the diversity gain that exists in cell phone towers around your house. It'll exist if you're doing in broadcasting, if you're doing wireless mics, you probably have a diversity system that will mix several antennas together and give you the best audio, stuff like that. Noise cancellation, though, is what I find the most useful. And that's where if you have one antenna that's picking up the distant signal that you want to hear plus the local noise, and if you can set up your other receiver just to get the local noise, then you can subtract the noise from the main antenna and get rid of it. And this is basically in very simple form how it works. Your desired signal is shown in teal. I think it's teal, blue or something. And the noise is shown in black. And if you can manage to get your noise probe or your noise antenna to focus mainly on noise, and then you bring it into your box and you phase shift at 180 degrees, well, 1 plus minus 1 equals 0, right? And so you can actually subtract the noise and you can end up with more of a desired signal that you want to listen to.
John, this is where my brain said, gosh, in an electric vehicle where we have locally generated noise in the inverters and all in the motors, what a great way to fix radio in an electric vehicle.
It would be, and there's actually some people are trying it right now, and it's the whole concept of just picking up the noise and phase reversing it and subtracting it from the main signal is just so bloody simple. Conceptually, it's going to take a bit of work to do electronically, but it does work. And I'll play you a video shortly to show you how well it actually does work. So similar but different effects, diversity gain, fights fading, array gain gives you a bit of a pattern, and noise cancellation lets you subtract local EMI from the signal you want to listen to. So that's the basic concept. You have some limitations with only two channels, like I'm using. You can only get diversity gain of around 3 to 6 dB, which is still something, but you need more antennas to get more. Your array gain, you're limited to single lobes and nulls, but depending what kind of antenna you're using, your nulls can be really deep. And so you can actually get a bit of a tuned antenna. I actually use my two loop system, which I'll show you in a minute, to do broadcast band DXing. And I can sit here at night on 730 kilohertz, and with one switch, with one phasing, I can listen to CKDM in Dauphin, Manitoba on 730, and I can reverse the phase and listen to Vancouver All Traffic Station on the same channel. And so it's brought back my interest in broadcast band DXing. Unfortunately, there's not much of interest to listen to in the evening, but I won't go there. Noise canceling is pretty much limited to a single interference signature at a time. So you pick the worst offender and you just do that cancellation. Okay, let's see if I can run the video now. Did I bring up the video?
Yes, you did.
Okay, so what I'm going to play, this is on the 25 meter ham band. And if you look over on the right of the screen, you'll see my phasing control. I can either mix the two antennas together or receiver one or receiver two. And then I can adjust the phase between them or the amplitude with this magic bullseye thing here. And what you'll see is my local RFI will show really, really bad. It'll just drown out the station. And then you can watch me just get rid of the interference completely. So here we go. Here we go. Why isn't it going? Oh yeah, start it.
Starting the economic development and improving people's lives as it faces what Kim called a great life and death struggle. Plenary meeting of the 8th Central Committee of the Workers' Party of Korea, which began on Monday. You can find our website, voanews.com. We also have a mobile app that you can download. Via remote, I'm Marissa Melton, VOA News.
Okay, so I hope that came through, but that's an example of diversity reception for noise cancellation. And I'm easily getting 30 to 40 dB reduction from broadband RFI. And so if you're in a house and you're in a city and you're on a ham radio and you're trying to get rid of local RFI, this is a great technique. It really does work. Okay, my setup, I've got three diversity gear right now. One is from Israel. It's called the Ephedri. It's a 12-bit, two-channel, and it works with power SDR. And that cost me $360. That's the top one. The SDR Play RSP Duo is probably my favorite for $280. It's a DC, a daylight diversity receiver. And I figured before I died, I wanted to buy a really good sort of industrial strength diversity receiver. So I got the Anan 7000, quite a bit more expensive. It's very solidly built. It works great. I'll be honest with you. You can get 80% of the performance with the RSP Duo for one-tenth the price, but such is life. And I've not actually transmitted with the Anan yet, but I'll probably get around to that one day. My setup, I'm using a pair of homemade 1 meter wideband loops, which you can see in a 100-foot array along the side of my house. And I can phase these against each other or against my ham antennas on the tower. And I've also got a couple of noise probes close to the neighbors' houses. And this is built with remote switching. So I can run this array as a two-element end fire 100 feet apart or a two-element broadside 100 feet apart. And I've actually got a little program I can use to switch those back and forth. So I can do various patterns. And if you've ever wondered how wideband loops work, this is actually modeling of that 730 kilohertz with a 100-foot array.
Hey, John?
Yep.
Just a heads up, I think there might be someone trying to join.
Oh, sorry.
It's all good.
Yeah. Done. The way these arrays work is you can get sort of an array factor based on the spacing and phasing, and you can get an element factor based on what the antenna is, and you can mix them together to create various patterns. And this is the two patterns I get from my east-west loop array to listen to those east or west stations on 730 kilohertz. I actually went and modeled it in, forget which one, MMANA, I think it was. Anyway, lots of playing around you can do with that. So just to wrap it up here, this system I've got is great for noise cancellation. I can get some steerable patterns out of the two loops, and I can get some diversity reception, which I don't really focus on that much. We focused on medium and high frequencies today. All of these techniques work from audio up to light.
No, just a wooden thing.
And there's lots of math you can go to study these things too. So maybe just to close up, I'm going to play that demonstration video again and then open it up for any questions.
Starting the economic development and improving people's lives as it faces what can involve a great life and death struggle. Plenary meeting of the 8th Central Committee of the Workers' Party of Korea, which began on Monday. Our website, voanews.com. We also have a mobile app that you can download via remote. I'm Marissa Nelson, VOA News.
Okay, I'll stop sharing now and I'll answer any questions you might have, and we can play with the dogs and someone else can take control away from me.
John, one thing that occurred to me was, we don't have home receivers hardly anymore, but if we did, and this SDR technology, software defined receiver technology, is getting to be so inexpensive that I could see a diversity receiver looking at all of the noise on the power line that powers the radio and comparing that to the antenna that the radio has to improve its reception there too.
Sure. And you know, I've stayed away from math today, but you know, most of your power line noise or your switch mode power supply interference has a very specific signature. And that signature is 120 hertz harmonics or 8.3 millisecond spikes on an oscilloscope. You could actually build an algorithm to lock onto that pattern or signature and use it to automatically reduce noise on your receiver. I haven't done that yet, but it's something I might get around to. If I was 20 years younger, I'd have done it by now, but.
Okay, and I'll say it again. I immediately saw the connection with electric vehicles to reduce noise. Where, you know, pick up a sample of the inverter that's making all this radio noise and just use it to cancel out what's coming in on the regular receive antenna. It sounds like a great idea.
Yeah, it is. And you want to learn more, there's tons of information on my website about it. And you can watch this video actually recorded on YouTube if you want to go and really desperate to watch it again.
And I'll put the I'll put the link on the on the SBE17.org website.
Yeah, so I know I'm not the host, but maybe Joe can mute his microphone.
Great. It's still open.
There you go.
Okay. So I could see the possibilities here with software-defined receivers. We could fix problems that heretofore were unfixable in my mind.
Yeah, you can. And I'm just going to go and grab something off the shelf and show it to you. Just give me a second.
So, Taylor, when you get the recording done, send me a link and I'll put it on the SBE17.org website quick as I can.
So yep. If you want
to... you should be the host now, too.
If you want to try an analog phasing box to get rid of noise, This little box is my X-Phase. You can buy it for $100 US online. It's my 3D printed case, but I've got level and phasing controls. And on the back, you can do BNCs, you can go UHF connectors. But for $100, you can build one of these from a kit, and you can give all these techniques a try for the noise cancellation. And you can even print your own box if you have a 3D printer.
I'm hoping car manufacturers get the plan and take off with it.
So that's it for me. Thanks very much for the opportunity to talk. Any questions anyone has, please ask or send me an email or whatever you like, and I'd be happy to answer them.
So okay. I'll be in a apartment eventually. Can I get enough spacing? Well, what frequencies will my spacing that I'll be able to get there be useful for divers?
Are you talking about using two wideband loops?
Maybe. They might have to be pretty small, though.
Okay. Well, if all you want to do is cancel noise, then the spacing doesn't matter as much as your ability to pick up noise on your noise antenna and then phase it against your main antenna. So if you if you've got 10 or 20 feet to do that, that'll work just fine. If you're in an apartment building, you've got probably so many sources of noise, you'll never get them all. But if you're in an apartment and you have an antenna on the roof and a separate noise antenna, you can phase the two together, you'll probably get rid of maybe half of it. You'll be able to go from an S9 noise level down to about S3 or 4, and you can actually make some contacts.
Mm-hmm. Great. Well, that's amateur radio speak, but it still works for people who are just on the listening end of radio. So great. And
I just became a ham. I haven't actually used my license yet, but I'm KD9UZO now.
Oh,
well. Trevor, I appreciate your question. You know, one of the problems a lot of new hams face is they're not exposed to high frequency that much because you probably start out with a DMR walkie-talkie or something like that. But maybe try finding some other hams with a really good HF station and go and see what it's like. And maybe your community actually even has an internet remote controllable station run by a club or someone. And that's another way to get started on HF as well, especially if you're in an apartment.
And I'll be giving you a tour of my ham station so you can get an idea.
Okay, cool.
So I'm going to back off. I'm going to put myself on mute and...
Okay, so good. I guess it's my turn. I do need to share screen. I'm Mark Persons, WNAW. That's a call sign for our National Association of Amateur Radio People. They're in Connecticut, and I've been a ham since I was 15, I think. And it's been great because I work my ham radio and my commercial radio together so that one works with the other. We're talking about the basic electronics, Ohm's law, all those things. And it's been really good because I can analyze a problem at a commercial station and say, well, I faced that in amateur radio. I know how to fix that problem. So let me share a screen and I'll show you my ham station, and please ask questions anytime you want. And I'm going to do that, and I'm going to do share, and then I'm going to do this. Okay. If you've got it right, you're looking at my repair shop. I must be right because I see their participants on the right-hand side. Any problems?
No.
Okay. Taylor, look okay to you?
Yeah.
Okay, great. So this is the repair shop that I've had for the past 20 years. Now, I've been retired for 5 years, but it still remains in place, partly because I still have a ham shack. I do things with the National Radio Systems Committee, coming up with technical specifications. I write for Radio World, and the shop just keeps servicing me. It's the right thing to do. I will tell you, on the way in the back there, there are some 1950s and 60s radios that I've lovingly restored. And interestingly enough, there is the Gonset twins, and I'm marking those with my mouse. Can you see my mouse moving? You should be able to, I hope so. Okay, good. We're talking 1950s technology before we had transceivers. We had a transmitter and we had a receiver. And these were mobile for a situation. Can you imagine those under the dashboard of your car? And they were good for 80 meters, which is 3.5 megahertz, up to 10 meters, which is 28 megahertz. And it was interesting that they got used in an interesting way, in that the transmitter at WELY radio, this mobile transmitter, was used in a car with a whip antenna, and the receiver was used at the studio to transport audio. It was a remote broadcast back in the day, and the FCC assigned 26 dot something megahertz, which these things easily converted to for use back then, and it was amplitude modulation, worked great. Talk about remote broadcast without a telephone line, and we're talking 1950s. So also in the back, you'll see lots of instruction manuals. On the right-hand side, there's pegboards with four bays worth of parts, which you can't really see, but the pegboards have all of the test leads on them. So it's really convenient. Anytime I needed something, turn around, pick up a test lead, go back to the bench. And let me go to the next. And a lot of stuff under the bench, wires and all that kind of stuff. Let me get over to the next slide. Okay, here's a better shot of the shop. And there are parts bins on the right. Up on top, frequency counter. Then a Radio Shack audio amplifier to run these two speakers. An AM stereo exciter, which I used for calibrating AM modulation monitors, FM stereo monitor, a patch bay for RF, and an FM mono monitor, frequency agile, and then a 1 gigahertz spectrum analyzer, which I did keep. I sold my other one, but this one I kept. What else is in here? An RF generator. Here is a receiver that will tune up to beyond 1 gigahertz. Audio distortion analyzer, audio oscillator. Below that, a watt meter for 25 megahertz and up, with a 600 watt dummy load, which made it really great for testing FM exciters and amplifiers, et cetera, et cetera. To the left of that, a 2 meter audio meter. So it's 2 needle audio meter. So you wind up with stereo metering, and a dual 100 megahertz oscilloscope, multimeter, variable AC power supply, wonderful tool for bringing voltage up on a piece of equipment that might have a problem, and you can see it, you know, you can track it easily. And up here, our signal generator, a Heath kit. Does anyone remember Heath kits? Here's another Heath kit, 400 volt power supply for tube type gear. Then below that, a couple of DC power supplies, a 15 volt and a 60 volt for all of our modern solid state stuff today. And a Sencor Z meter, which is just terrific for checking capacitors, putting 600 volts on them if you want to see if they'll arc over. Not shown here on the left is a Sencor Super Cricket semiconductor tester. So next slide. Okay, I got that one. Okay, this is my wife Paula and I. She is also a ham. I am W0MH. She is W0HA. And ham licenses, you can't buy. You have to test into them. And when we did it, it was 20 words a minute Morse code. Today, it's not required for Morse code, but you do need to know electronic theory. Only cost you like, I don't know what they're charging now, $15 for the license. That's, but the examination part, that's the hard part. Let's take a more close look at the station, what's going on here. You'll see a couple of clocks. This is local time, and then there's Greenwich time, because a lot of hams converse in, oh, I'll see you at 1600 Greenwich. Okay, well, better know when, you know, where you are in relation to that. Then on the upper left, there is it's a 2 meter, which is 144 megahertz transceiver. It's all mode, AM, FM, upper sideband, lower sideband, CW, which is like Morse code. Then there's a switch next to it to decide whether it goes to the antenna. Oh, there's a watt meter too. If it goes to the antenna or this other 144 megahertz and 70 centimeter, which is 440 megahertz, which one of those goes to the antenna. And in the middle is clear speaker. It's digital device that will clean up a lot of noise. Remarkable technology, and it's all done in a digital chip. It's not the savior of everything, and I don't know that it would work in a entertainment venue like commercial or public radio where you want bandwidth. But for amateur radio, it does a wonderful job cleaning everything up. And then there is an antenna analyzer. We'll talk about that in a minute. And a watt meter to see how much power is going to the antenna. In the lower tier here, here's a 2 kilowatt dummy load, intermittent 2 kilowatt. An antenna tuner for my multi-band antenna so I can get 50 ohms out of it for this ICOM 7300 transceiver, which is, it'll work from, 160 meters, which is 1.8 megahertz, up to 6 meters, which is 50 megahertz, plus or minus. And I can use it with AM, FM, lower sideband, upper sideband, mostly used on sideband. And that's a 100 watt rig. Then next to it is a 1 kilowatt linear amplifier. And so that helps, especially when we're doing a net talking around the five-state area on Saturday mornings. You want to be heard by everybody, and especially if I'm net control, you want all the stations to hear me. Anyway, there is a band selector switch and some tuning controls because, gosh, we move around to a lot of different frequencies. And in the process of doing that, you'll see a close-up here on the left of selecting the 80-meter dipole, the all-band antenna, the 20-meter, and on and on. And what I do with that is I select the antenna that I plan to use. Then with the switch on the right, I move it from normal over to analyzer. What happens is the analyzer, it's a visoir meter and a resistance meter, and it tells me how the antenna is performing. as in, is it going to work for me? Well, more than once, I've done this before I transmitted or pushed the transmit button and found out that all had gone wrong. A tree had taken down a wire on my antenna or something. So I knew not to even try to transmit into it until all was well. In the background, you'll see a gray box, and there's another gray box down here, and we'll be talking about those in a few seconds. In fact, now would be the time. Okay, this box has what an electrician might use as a 30 amp, 240 volt relay. In this case, it's powered by 12 volts. Now, this box is lightning protection for me, and I built it from parts. Easy to do. It's 7 inches long from end to end. Now, the closest connector here, SO239, mates with the PL259. The center conductor goes to the relay. And to reduce the inductance induced by the relay, I laid on some strap here and soldered it to the armature of the relay. And under normal circumstances, when my transceiver is not turned on, the relay is relaxed. That center conductor from the transceiver goes to the top contact here, and then goes right down to chassis ground. It in essence shorts out the input or the output of my rig, the outer conductor to the center conductor, and the connector in the rear is a similar story. That's the one for the antenna. So it comes up and the center conductor of the antenna also goes to ground, and the whole thing is lightning and static protection. Now, when the transceiver is turned on, the relay pulls in. And I'm not talking just transmit, I'm talking about whenever the transceiver is turned on, there's 12 volts here. What happens? The transceiver line goes, and when the relay pulls in, it pulls down and connects to the bottom contact, okay? Then there is a brass bolt that goes to the bottom contact on the other side, and it follows the braid out to the antenna. And it works like $1 million. And I don't have to worry about lightning problems, not completely, but I don't have the same worries about lightning problems that I used to have years ago. And I wanted to show you this because down in the front of each one of the, like the tuner and the RF amplifier, are some handwritten notes. And these are the notes. Because hams work on so many different frequencies, you have all of these dial settings to handle. For instance, for this, the top one is for the RF amplifier. For 160 meters, 1850 kilohertz, I need 70 watts of drive for the linear. The band switch needs to be in the 160 position, the plate knob at 4, and the load at 3. And so for all these different frequencies, which are just terribly diverse from each other, you need a set of numbers. An interesting thing for the bottom piece of paper here, this is the antenna tuner that can take gosh awful impedances and turn them into 50 ohms for the transceiver to see. And these are all the settings. It just makes it so much easier. Now, we had a chance 20 years ago to build our own home, and I got to engineer it like I would engineer a radio station. So on the right-hand side, the most minor of all the things, that's the sprinkler the controller, and up above it, you see the map showing each of the zones. And then to the left of that is the off-peak electric. And then there's this incoming city electric. And then below that, there's ductwork here to connect that to a generator transfer panel that's fully automatic. And I'm going to go to the next slide because it shows it better. There we go. There are two 200 amp panels. There's only a 200 amp service, but I needed all those for the enough circuit breakers to run all the circuits because I'm real big on having lots of power. And every room has 20 amp outlets and 15 amp lights. And so there's maybe twice as many circuits running to a room just because that's the right way to do it. You've seen it before. You go into a room, you plug in something, and boom, you kill the power to the room and the lights go out at the same time. Well, that doesn't happen in this scenario. I will show you that in the left-hand rack at near the bottom is a 3000 watt UPS. And its job with this smaller service panel is to provide power to the phone systems, to the internet, to the alarms, all those things, the racks of computers, all the computers in the place, and it's done through this panel. And I will show you the battery supply. This is the back end of the UPS. I found that UPSs like to heat up their batteries a lot. So external was the name of the game for me. There's a box on the wall that's labeled UPS. And the whole idea is I can easily, in seconds, patch around a dead UPS if that happened. But right now it's plugged into the box and that wiring could all be changed easily without a screwdriver. Also, there is a wall wart transformer and it powers this voltmeter that's on the batteries all the time. So I can always check, see what the voltage looks like at any one moment. And then when I do a full system test of the UPS, as in I kill the incoming power from the city, I watch how the battery performs on the UPS to see if it needs replacing. Here's more. You're probably mostly all using voice over IP. This is 20-year-old technology. Actually, it's much older than that. I got it for a song in 20 years ago, and it's performed beautifully for us so far, phone system. All the phone wiring on 110 blocks and computer wiring here, which I'm in the process of making big changes to. Here's the underneath side of the power. And I actually only discovered much later that all of this space here is supposed to be for the 120 volts, not for what I did, but it worked out so well. And I'm sure glad I was ignorant at the moment, but this is a single point ground. You see the copper strap? We have those in broadcast all the time. The strap goes off to the left and around the corner to the rack. So they're all on a common point ground, single point ground. And that single point ground is tied right to the incoming electrical panel and to the multiple ground rods outside. And I've got a more detailed photo to show you here too. Each of the lines coming in from the outside, like the tower, come in up high, actually, like 2 feet above the floor. They go through multiple turns of cable and then down to these surge protectors. And they're all tied to that ground strap. And the inductance in the lines helps prevent lightning from getting in. If it does, it goes right to that single point ground. That's the right thing to do. And all of the stuff coming in actually goes to that. I should have pointed that out a few seconds ago, but we've got cable, telephone protectors, cable TV, you name it. It all goes onto that strap, which is the right thing to do. Here is an example of a commercial installation, 4-inch transmission line. And then all the cables coming in the building get a strap over to the strap that goes to ground, all trying to keep lightning from coming in. Now, this is the tower at my place. I wound up for a song getting a tower from a tower contractor. As you well know, you can't take a used tower and put it back up and then insure it. Well, I didn't really insure my tower. I just got it and cleaned it up, took the paint off, put this brown color on it, rust preventative. It's 80 feet of tower and 15 feet of it is in concrete in the ground. So this 65 feet self-supports itself above that concrete. And there's this handsome guy who resembles me, who's at the top of the tower, and I'm making changes to the tower. This white antenna on the top, that's for the 2-meter 440, which is 144 megahertz and 440 megahertz local communications antenna. I've got static cat here, Gila-Stat. It's sharp points to bleed off static charges to the sky. The all-band antenna is these two wires from this center point here held away from the tower, and they're about 200 feet of wire there, and then it's fed by 450 ohm ladder line going down to a balanced to unbalanced converter near the bottom of the tower, balanced to unbalanced. And today's project involved replacing this ballon with a different ballon. And that's why the coaxial cable here is at this moment disconnected from this other antenna, which is a 20 meter inverted V. So the two sides come down at about 45 degrees from each other. And let's see. Okay, here's another look at that at the static dissipator. I know we use them in broadcast a lot, and I became quite convinced that they work great. Here's one at the top of another tower, not mine. There was a 3-tower array in Brainerd, 360 foot in the middle and a couple 180 footers on the sides. And it used to get hit every summer. There'd be lightning damage, and it was like insurance damage and all this other stuff. And when a new owner bought the tower, bought the station, I says, listen, we'll just spend a few extra bucks. We're going to have guys, tower climbers out there anyway. They're going to check the tower for everything, and they'll straighten it and all that stuff. And I says, how about if we just throw some of these static dissipators in their hands and put them up? So we did. And that was like 12 years ago. Not one insurance claim since. Not that they solved all the problems, but guess what? A tornado came through shortly after that, took down one of the 180 foot towers, and the other one was fine. And you know there had to have been lightning everywhere. Anyway, it lived through it. All right, more to say. Circuit breaker panel in my house, the surge breaker plugs in like a two-pole breaker and is good for protecting the power lines. Here is a Kohler 22 kilowatt generator plant. It's a Ford four-cylinder engine, and it's powered by propane. And then there's a battery here with heat on it and all that stuff. Works like $1 million. Inside the house is the transfer panel. You've probably seen those things before. Power comes in from the bottom. That's the city power. Output power goes to the rest of the facility. Generator power comes in. And then you'll also notice that the white ones, the neutrals, are not connected to ground. Neutrals only connect to ground in the incoming electrical panel. This is what city power looks like in Brainerd. It's just under a 2% harmonic distortion. This is what the Kohler generator looks like, darn close to it and still under 2%. This is what the APC UPS looks like when it's trying to generate those 60 hertz sine waves from digital. Not too bad, very good. Here's a typical gas-driven generator plant. Here is a 4-kilowatt typical plant, a Sportsman model Gen 4000 at 50% load. Not very good. I don't think your UPSs would be happy with that. I know they wouldn't be happy with this one. This is a ground-mounted Winco 8-kilowatt plant running on natural gas. Terrible. You have to know what you're buying when you buy these things. Here's lightning damage, a utility pole next to a radio studio. Lightning came down, split out the pole, and headed over to the STL dish. And when it got inside, this is what happened. There was lots of damage, as you can well imagine. Here's a computer, just Here's another line. And here is what the manager was showing me. All of this stuff was toast. So this is what a properly constructed transmitter plant looks like. You've got incoming power on the left, goes to a surge protector, and then goes to a safe station reference ground. You remember I was mentioning single point ground? And then goes out to the tower. So lightning hits, comes down the coaxial feeder, and the shield goes to the surge protector's station reference ground right there. And then to add a little extra help, there's some ferrites there, but the real thing is the lightning comes in and goes out, you give it to hand it off to the power company. They can deal with it. Okay, here's a properly constructed generator, transmitter plant, but let's assume that this line on the right going out to the tower, your RF transmission line, what if it was just connected to the transmitter? Line comes in and lightning comes in, goes to the transmitter, finds ground on the other side of the transmitter. Now you've got the transmitter as the fusible link, the part that'll go bad when lightning hits. Instead, they've taken the coaxial cable transmission line, tied it to the reference ground, and then sent it over to the transmitter. That's the right way to do it. I caution people against ground adapters. There's a ground pin on three-wire cables for a reason, to keep things safe. You've seen these child protectors on outlets. I use them wherever I don't want people tampering. Now, quick story. I climbed my tower one day and a hornet stung me. Well, after I got over it, I found a friend who had a beekeeper's helmet and beekeeper's gloves, climbed up there and gave them hell. So that was me, and you could see them everywhere, hornets. And you should have seen what it looked like from the inside of the helmet, the hat, with those hornets looking at me, trying to get in. Ouch. So on the next sunny day, 2 days later, I was up there again and scraping off what was left of the hornet's nest. And I know we're running short on time. So this is my last slide. This is your handsome tower climber, all wet because he walked through the sprinklers of the lawn a little earlier. But I'm wearing an OSHA-approved harness. And you've probably seen those before with the big, and it just takes me two or three times as long to climb a tower using that. But it's really safe too. So that's the plan. Any questions? I'd be glad to answer them.
Have you found a way to keep the hornets from coming back?
Well, I don't know of a way to keep them from coming back, but I'm fully prepared to check the tower before I ever go up. And I know where I can get the beekeeper's helmet, so I'm good there. So. Oh, and way in the background, there's a fence around the tower. And it's about a 10-foot by 10-foot fence just to keep people out, because you've got those liability problems. And no, I don't climb other people's towers, liability. And no, I don't fix modulation monitors or other equipment, because again, it's liability in the shop. But I use the shop for productive purposes in my writing for Radio World and for the National Radio Systems Committee.
Back on your grounding strap in your basement, how did you know how many loops you needed to put in to create that inductance?
I didn't. More is better. It's what I had. What I just pulled a bunch in, and I cut off next to nothing when the time was right to connect them up. So there's no magic number.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, and you can do that, you know, in every studio you've got, or every studio facility where you've got an STL dish or anything like that. It's a proven technology. And use the static dissipators too. Prevent the problem that happened. That was actually in Monoman, Minnesota. And I went up there to photograph it just to see how bad it was. It wasn't one of my stations, so I can blame someone else.
Oh, thanks, Mark, for bringing back lots of memories. It's been probably the last time I was in a transmitter site was 1982, 83. So, well, obviously a ham site I've been in, but you've brought back a lot of memories of the old broadcast plants and how much fun it was to be on call and have that pager go off when something went wrong at 2 o'clock in the morning. That part I don't miss.
Yeah, the fun went out of it for me at about age 63, I think, and I hung on till age 70 and finally said enough is enough. But and I did find three people to replace me. So it took three people to replace Paula and I in our area of the world. And so, we didn't sell our business. We could have sold it for a lot of money, but we didn't. We had the money, and we didn't need to put someone in debt. That's how we felt. So I mentor them, and in return for mentoring, I get free lunch.
Yeah, a lot of people today with cell phones don't remember pagers, I guess. But my claim to fame is I actually once threw one in the toilet and flushed it. That was at 2 o'clock in the morning, and it was just the announcer was really lonely. There wasn't really a problem. He just wanted someone to talk to.
Well, people have done that with cell phones too, you know.
Yeah, I'm sure.
Good riddance to the pager. Well, good, having people show up to learn about this, and there'll be a video too. It's just passing along the knowledge that I've acquired along the way.
I got a question.
Yes.
Have you either of you done international travels in amateur radio? I bring it up just because Trevor is probably going to be in that situation at some point.
I have not. What about you, John?
So I haven't either, but that's only because, you know, when I go on international travel, I'm spending time with my wife and kids and stuff and not playing with radio. But there's a lot of people will get reciprocal licensing, and they can go to other countries and operate club stations or take their own station along. And that can be a lot of fun. What's really interesting is the way radio propagation works is completely different depending on where you are. Like, and you know, if you're on the East Coast, you can hear lots of the European stations really strong because you're only one or two hops away from Europe. And if you're on the West Coast, you can get better quality into Japan and so on. So it's fun. And some hams actually, they will rent a ham vacation station down in the Caribbean or whatever, and they'll take a week off and go and rent the place fully equipped and go on the air.
Now, during the peak of the last 11-year cycle, when things were really hopping, from my car in Minnesota, I wound up talking to stations in Australia, Europe, the Soviet Union, and Japan. I mean, it just happened. Now, but that doesn't happen all of the 11-year cycle, but from my car yet.
Yeah, I operated down in St. Lucia and had a local ham license, but it's not as easy to do anymore. And technically, you're supposed to send them your serial number of the equipment you're bringing and all that stuff. And they just want to ensure that it leaves without not getting sold to somebody that is bypassing taxes and things like that. So it's interesting trying to operate in another country.
There are de-expeditions where they spend $100,000 or more going to some island in the middle of nowhere. And I've talked to some of those things too. I can't remember, down near South Pole, and it's fun. And you only get to talk to him for 5 seconds or 10 seconds at the most, and to make contact. And in the process, they have like 15,000 contacts from all over the world. But and then we can all put it on our world maps, a pin that shows, oh, we talked at this place in Antarctica or something like that.
So, Mark, can I share my screen for just a sec?
Oh, sure. Here, let me get rid of mine. Maybe I can't find the control for it.
Here, I can do it this way.
Okay.
And
no, it's
back to you, John.
Oh, there we are. So for those of you that just want to listen, you can write down the link of this website. Every pin in this map is a remote controllable software defined radio that tunes from broadcast band all the way up through HF. And if you want to listen to one of these radios, say you want to pick a station to listen to in where's this, Jeddah? No, in Kuwait, you can actually go and connect to it. Yeah, here it comes, and open it up. Anyway, there's just a quick example of how you can actually just share receivers all around the world. And you can just go and select one of them, and you can listen to shortwave from South America, Australia, whatever. And this site is up 24 hours a day. There's usually around 200 stations you can go and click into.
It's also showing gray line, yeah. Which is what propagation goes well along that edge between night and day. And that's, I think that's how I talked to Australia that one time from my car.
Okay, I'm going to pop off now and go play with the grandchildren. Thanks a lot, Mark, and everybody. It's been good joining you today.
Thanks, John, for sharing your information.